Alrighty, well, good morning, everybody.
Yeah.
And welcome to True Grace Bible Ministry.
Yeah.
Once again, my name is Mike Marcheski, and it's good to have you guys with us. Yeah. Alright, last week we looked at time past, but now in ages to come. Yeah. And we looked at some of the foundations of that, okay? And as you folks know, that the confusion in churches today is because folks don't understand the time past, the but now, the ages to come. And that word dispensation is another problem with people, okay? A lot of groups and people out there think that this word dispensation and dispensational Bible study is man's way of studying and understanding the Bible. But if we clearly look into things we've been doing here at this ministry for the last 5.5 years, right division is the only way the Bible makes sense. And study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
Yeah.
And as we've looked in the past, right division is about prophecy and the revelation of the mystery. Turn to Acts chapter 2.
Get away.
Acts chapter 2. And of course that's the day of Pentecost, okay?
Yeah.
And it is still God dealing with the nation of Israel. We're going to go right to verse 22. Just so we can see these things. Ye men of Israel, hear these words, okay? Peter is still addressing Israel. That is still considered time past. Now let's come into Acts chapter 3. Look at verse 12. And when Peter, okay, saw it and answered, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel. See, Peter is still addressing Israel, folks. And the things that were spoken to Israel during this time have to do with prophecy. And Acts chapter 2 has to do with prophecy. Let's go back to chapter 2, verse 16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. See, Joel was a prophet to the nation of Israel. And the things that Joel spoke were about Israel's future. Has nothing to do with the church, the body of Christ. And it shall come to pass. Okay? See, this is all prophecy. The things that Peter quotes from Joel has to do with prophecy. And the point I'm getting at is now when we come back into chapter 3, when Peter legitimately gives an offer of the kingdom to ye men of Israel, he says in verse 18 of chapter 3, But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all his holy prophets, that Christ should suffer, he has so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. Has to do with this new covenant coming into force from Jeremiah 31, okay? When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ. This is the second coming, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the time of restitution of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. So when we rightly divide the word of truth, it is between prophecy, which was spoken since the world began. And this is what Peter's talking about here, right after the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 3. It's still considering time past. God dealing with the nation of Israel. Under God's operation of that, if I may say it, the prophecy program to Israel. Folks, it's the only way the Bible makes sense. Okay? It is the only way. Is if we rightly divide it, and we want to call it separated or compartmentalize, however you want to word it, okay? We must do these things. We must keep them separated. It's the only way the Bible makes sense. Now, come with me to Romans 16 and verse 25. Now to him that is power to establish you according to my gospel. When Paul says my gospel, he's talking about the death, burial, and resurrection. Your gospel is salvation and my gospel is salvation. Okay? Ephesians 1:13. And the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. See, now there's a difference, isn't there? The revelation of the mystery, which was revealed to the Apostle Paul, was kept secret since the world began. But now is manifested. See, there's a difference, isn't there?
Yeah.
Okay? The things that prophecy spoke of, or speaks to us in the Scriptures, was spoken since the world began. What the Apostle Paul speaks to us was kept secret since the world began. And folks, this is it. I can't say it any other way. But distinguishing between the time past and the but now is so important. And folks just don't want to accept that fact that the Apostle Paul is your apostle and mine today. And the dispensation of grace, the age of grace, the church age. You folks, I'll be honest with you. I don't really care what you call it. Okay? We're operating today, God's operating, I should say, under grace. He's dispensed his word to the Apostle Paul. Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which was given me to you word, how that by revelation he made it known unto me. Okay. Saul, who is now Paul, on the road to Damascus, Acts chapter 9, when God said that he would use Paul. He is a chosen vessel. See, things have changed. We have to lovingly get this message to people. That the things that Jesus said while on earth were to Israel. Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises unto the Father. He did that. Jesus Christ fulfilled prophecy when he died on the cross, when he was buried and he rose again. That was fulfilled prophecy. That's why he came. But now, folks, there's a difference, okay? When we see that but now, it means there's a change. And that change is that we have one apostle for one body, both Jew and Gentile, in one body. Let's keep reading in Ephesians. Chapter 3, verse 4. Whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. And when Paul says, but the mystery, he's talking back here in Acts chapter 2, in verse 16, when he says that he might reconcile both unto God in one body, by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Okay, folks, he's talking about the twain, the one new man. That's the church, the body of Christ. Both Jew and Gentile, one body. That's the but now. In time past, you had 12 apostles, 12 tribes. We don't have that today, do we? We have one body, one apostle. We need to patiently, and it's hard sometimes, But get that point across to folks, that it's both Jew and Gentile, one body. There's no difference today. When God looks down here today, he does not, he's not a respecter of persons. He does not distinguish between Jew and Gentile, Afghanistan, Iranian, Mexican, Polish. He does not do that. When God looks upon this earth today, he sees two types of people. Those in Christ that have trusted the gospel of their salvation, how that Christ died for your sins, was buried, and rose again. If you've trusted in that, you've been baptized, you've been placed into Christ. The other group of people are those that are still in Adam. Wherefore, it is by one man sin entered into the world. Okay? So, by one man, Adam, all are condemned. Go to Romans. You'll see what I'm talking about. There are only two groups of people in the world today, folks. Those in Adam, those in Christ. Romans 5:12. Wherefore is by one man sin entered into the world, death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And that word death, remember, that is a separation. It's not annihilation. Death, separation has passed upon all men. Come down with me. Here in Romans chapter 5. Look at verse 16. And not as it was by one that sinned, so the gift for the judgment was by one unto condemnation. But the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. So you're either justified in Christ or condemned in Adam. That's it. For by one man's offense, death reigned by one, much more they which reign receive abundance of grace and of the holy gift of and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. So we see condemnation and righteousness. Verse 18. Therefore, as by one the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation. All men to condemnation. Even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. So folks, the opportunity has been given to all folks. Okay? It's the salvation of God has appeared to all men. He says in Titus chapter 2. Okay? It's available to all. Romans chapter 3. Let's look at Romans 3 for a second. Verse 21 says, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto and upon all them that what? Believe. So God's righteousness is now available to all those that believe. And for those that don't believe and trust the gospel of their salvation, they're still under condemnation. Okay, that's the way God sees people today. You're either in Adam, condemned, or you're in Christ and justified. There is no difference today. And yes, in the dispensation of grace. And it's the gospel of the grace of God that we're to preach. How that Christ died for your sins, was buried, and rose again. The gospel of the kingdom that Jesus and the 12 preached was still in time past. Okay? Time past is dealing with Israel and them accepting Jesus Christ as their Messiah, setting up his kingdom on earth. Whereas today, we're to preach Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. Now, you always hear, or you may always hear, well, we have to follow Jesus. And I agree with that 100%. We do need to follow Jesus, but we need to follow Jesus according to the but now. We can't follow Jesus according to the time past. Okay? Let's look at Romans, 1 Corinthians 11 once, okay? Verse 1. Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. See, folks, we follow Jesus Christ today. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 37. See, folks, the but now, we preach Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. It's now being revealed to us. It's the dispensation that God has given to Paul for us. In verse 37 of 1 Corinthians 14, says, if any man think of himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. So what Paul writes to us in Romans to Philemon during the but now are the commandments of the Lord. We follow Jesus Christ, but we don't follow his earthly ministry, do we?
No.
We follow his heavenly ministry. Remember again here, let's look at what Romans 16 said. Now to him that is power to establish you according to my gospel. When Paul says my gospel, and that he received it according to the revelation of the mystery, turn to Galatians with me, chapter 1, verse 11. Paul said, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by revelation of Jesus Christ. That's Paul's gospel. He received it by revelation. Okay? Revelation. Something that was once kept secret, but now is manifest. Okay? And what was manifest is how that Christ died for our sins, was buried, and rose again. See, in the but now, that death, burial, and resurrection, if I may use these terms, is our plan of salvation. See, but in time past, it was fulfillment of prophecy. Let's look at that first. Why did Jesus Christ raise from the dead? You know, that's an important question. We have the quote-unquote Easter time coming up, okay? So, why did Jesus Christ rise from the dead in time past? And time past still covers, okay, the beginning of Acts and Pentecost, Acts chapter 3, okay? Time past still covers that. Time past is Jesus' earthly ministry. Acts chapter 2. Let's look at verse 30. Let's go to verse 29. Remember what verse 22 said. We mentioned it earlier. That ye men of Israel. So Peter is addressing Israel. Now verse 29 says, men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God has sworn with an oath to him, that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. I think that's very simple. So why did Jesus Christ raise from the dead for Israel? To sit on the throne of David. The things that were spoken since the world began. go back to 2 Samuel, chapter 7. And we'll go to verse 10. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people, Israel, and will plant them that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more, neither shall the children of the wickedness afflict them any more as before time. And as since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused thee to rest from all thine enemies, also the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house. Verse 12. And when thy days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of the bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build an house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. Okay? That throne that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead was to sit on that throne of David. Okay? Remember, time past has to do with prophecy for the nation of Israel. In verse 12 of 2 Samuel, we see, and when thy days be fulfilled, is when this kingdom would be set up. Let's come into Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. Let's go, look at what verse 14 says. It says, now, after that John the Baptist, was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. He never preached the gospel of the grace of God. He's preaching the gospel of the kingdom, which was prophesied since the world began. But the gospel of the grace of God was kept secret since the world began. Look at verse 15. And saying, the time is fulfilled. Goes back to 2 Samuel. Prophecy is being fulfilled. And when thy days be fulfilled, I will establish his kingdom. Back there in 2 Samuel. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. What gospel? The only gospel Jesus ever preached. The gospel of the kingdom. And that's why Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. To sit on this throne. But folks, that had to deal with time past. Time past deals with prophecy and the nation of Israel. Things that were spoken since the world began. But now, okay, there's a change. Let's look at Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4. Let's look at what the scripture says as to why Jesus Christ was raised from the dead now. The but now. In the dispensation of the grace of God. Romans chapter 4 verse 24. But for us also, talking about the imputed righteousness that was given to Abraham, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses, he died for our sins, and he was raised again for our justification. See, there's a difference. Christ is now being raised for our justification, for the church, the body of Christ. But for Israel, under prophecy and the fulfillment of prophecy, it was to sit on the throne of David. Remember what we read in Romans chapter 5? We'll read 16 again. Romans 5:16. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift, for the judgment was by one to condemnation. But the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. So, as we come into this Easter season, the resurrection time, do you see how important the resurrection of Jesus Christ is for us? If he didn't raise from the dead, we'd still all be under condemnation, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
We'd all be guilty. Where do guilty people go? The Bible speaks of hell, okay? The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. See, Christ raised from the dead, was risen from the dead, so that we could be justified. That's the but now. That's the difference. And folks, it's not twisting and mingling scriptures together to make them fit. Like some people say we do, that teach the Bible dispensationally. But what we need to do, okay, see these sledgehammers?
Yeah.
Okay? I keep these sledgehammers in front of our little table here to remind people. We have to break down foundations that have been taught. 90-some percent of churches do not understand right division. And they think we teach this Bible ultra-dispensationally and call us all kind of names. But folks, let's do it in love. Let's help break down those foundations that have been taught for people that have cracks in them. Okay? Let's use the sledgehammer of scriptures, rightly divided, to help people understand. Especially during this time we're coming up of the, I say it again, the Easter season. The importance of the resurrection. See, Christ is not on the cross yet today, is he?
No.
If he stayed on the cross and never was put into that grave, number one, he wouldn't have fulfilled prophecy that was spoken of him. So that would have made the Bible wrong there again, and God a liar. But now, okay, the things that were revealed to the Apostle Paul by revelation, how that Christ raised from the dead for our justification, that we could be declared not guilty. Folks, that's the difference. Things spoken since the world began, and things kept secret since the world began. And Paul says it, okay, go to 1 Corinthians 15. We looked at Mark 14. Let's look at Mark 14 again. If you went to 1 Corinthians 15, keep your finger there, okay? We're coming right back here. But if you look at Mark chapter 1 again, verses 14 and 15, now that after John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. See, they think that we should be preaching this gospel that Jesus preached. And then they want to take you to Mark 16, in verse 15, and say unto them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Well, the only gospel message, okay, good news, is that the kingdom is at hand. And if they repent and believe who Jesus Christ is, then the kingdom that was prophesied to them, which was spoken since the world began, could be theirs. The gospel of the kingdom is the only message that was revealed yet. Because we'd have to go all the way up here to Acts chapter 9 when Saul gets saved on the road to Damascus. The gospel of the grace of God was still kept secret. The way we get saved today in the dispensation of grace. Paul's gospel was still kept secret until Acts chapter 9. Now go to 1 Corinthians 15. Moreover, brethren, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved. By which ye are saved. Okay? Oh, I wish, if there's such a thing as wishing, I pray, I should say, that people would understand this, that the only way to be saved today is to trust the gospel of the grace of God. The gospel of the kingdom will save nobody. What Jesus preached back there in Mark will not save a person today. Mm. We must preach this gospel, by which you also ye are saved, if you keep your memory which I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all, that which also I received, that how Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Remember, he was given for our offenses, raised for our justification, Romans 4, 24 and 25. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Folks, this is the gospel of our salvation. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. It says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. The good news of your salvation and mine is that Christ died, was buried, and rose again. The plan of our salvation. That's it. The gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Folks, that's the but now. That is the importance of the resurrection. See, the time past resurrection was for Israel. There's been changes. We folks, okay, that understand these scriptures, rightly divide it. We must lovingly, patiently, Paul says, okay, teach Paul's word. Go to 2 Timothy 2, verse 1. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. See, we're to teach what Paul preached and taught to folks. And that comes from Romans 16, 25. Now to him that has power to establish you according to my gospel, and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. See, now today, see, in time past, salvation was of the Jews, wasn't it?
Yeah.
John 4, 22. Okay. See, now it's to all nations. All nations mean all people. All nations mean Gentiles. And that's who Paul is. He's the apostle of the Gentiles. All nations now, without distinction. That is the but now. So, having an understanding of the time past, the but now, and ages to come, especially what was spoken since the world began, and things that were kept secret since the world began, is the key to understanding our scriptures rightly divided. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So folks, prayerfully, As I say it again, this Easter season coming up, the resurrection season, what we call it as well. Let's proclaim the truth of the gospel. Let's proclaim what Paul says, my gospel, Paul's gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection. And it's by faith and faith alone, or should I say through faith, as Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 says, that you're saved by grace, through faith, not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. It's a free gift. You can't work for it. Just trust it. And in this world we're living in today, it is the only thing that will change people. So let's be the ambassadors that we're called to be and help people understand time past, but now, and ages to come. Father, thank you for this time. Pray that we bring glory to you through this ministry. Continue to bless it and use it. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Beautiful. I guess, yeah.